probably been playing it, and it is actually first pick worthy on the side of Super Hot Crew. So it's quite smart play, and we're still sticking to the trend of denying champions for Selfie. That's two mid lane bans. I wouldn't be surprised to see a LeBlanc as the third and final ban.
Well, Jax, like you mentioned, was taken, so top laners focused a fair bit. They are the two most favored top laners so far. And of course, the final ban, there it is, Ryze. That's another top laner, or could be mid laner. Selfie's played it in the mid as well, so that's technically three centered mid lane bans from Cloud9 Eclipse. This is what we thought. Selfie is going to get focused.
Yeah, I think it's the most successful strategy when you consider Impaler's got a wide champion pool. He's added a lot of junglers that he can do well with. Kha'Zix, for example, as well as the likes of his Pantheon and his Vi, which he can fall back to. What I do want to see is how the Super Hot Crew build their team composition. We've seen Mr. Rolls running Draven in the past. The only reason I highlight that fact is if they leave the AD carry role to later, not locking an early Lucian, maybe Mr. Rolls is going to be confident. Maybe he wants to try and pull it out, you know, get some bank from a passive and try snowball the game.
Well, Mixer was fairly proud of his record for most deaths in the LCS. He has locked in Leona, so that is an all-in champion. We'll hope that that doesn't continue, but we also see LeBlanc and Kha'Zix getting locked in for Eclipse.
So Mixer's never won a game on Leona. Four times played, zero victories with that champion. We'll see if he's going to break that train today. Touching on the Kha'Zix and the LeBlanc, you've got Mobility and Assassination. Cloud9 have already got the makings of a strong pick composition, and we'll need to see how they round out like their tanky top laner. You still have Dr. Mundo in the pool, who is very strong on 4.5 with the likes of Teleport Heal or something like that. And we'll need to see if Maima or Oduamne want to play it.
No, we're waiting to see what Super Hot Crew lock in. Well, no surprises there. They're making sure Mr. Ryze is safe on a comfortable champion. He is very nervous coming to this one. We managed to speak to him before this game, so he's very nervous about this. And as you'd expect all of these players to be, but it is going to be Lucian for him. We're waiting to see whether that Lulu is going to get locked in. It is. Now, the question is this Maima, who has been practicing it, or is this Selfie? Because a lot of his champions have been banned away from him.
A lot of the champions have. Considering how Maima likes to play the tanky champions more so, Renekton is his most played, then Shyvana, then Dr. Mundo at 11-6-6. I'm more expecting Maima to go for a beefy tank and Selfie to grab that Lulu in the mid lane. So there are two picks to come in, and it does look like that's going to be the case.
Yeah, we'll see whether that one gets locked in. Karma has been picked. That is going to be a support Karma. Of course, you've all seen Bjergsen playing it in that mid lane over in the playoffs, but with LeBlanc in there, it's almost certainly going to be a support. Could have a LeBlanc support, you never know. But this is the interesting one, Graves. Graves has been locked in over in the North American scene and the Korean scene recently. We haven't seen it in Europe just yet, but here it is. And it's really all about the bullying against Lucian.
Yes, and he's a brawler, so he can trade with damage with Lucian if you are up close. Get the Buckshot down, especially when you're dealing with, when you have the support of the poke of your Karma. But part of the reason Graves has risen in popularity in recent weeks is his passive True Grit gives him a lot of armor and magic resistance. So when you're dealing with champions that want to get in your face, like a Lulu, a Renekton, a Leona, anybody's going to be diving at you, you get all of those free bonus stats. When you have the shields coming in from Karma, those bonus stats apply to the shield, which makes you even more tanky and more difficult in conjunction with the power of heal. So it's a smart brawler pick. What I also like is the power of Karma to speed up and boost the assassins that are already on Cloud9's team. The problem Cloud9 have, if they don't find those picks early on, you're going to be in this position where they've got these pick champions that can't blow people up. Renekton, Zinn, Leona, and a Lulu Wild Growth are going to be very difficult to blow up. I feel like Super Hot Crew, if they play their composition correctly, can avoid the burst damage of Cloud9 Eclipse, and we need to see how they handle themselves in the early to mid game.
Yeah, well, as you mentioned, that Renekton had been locked in, so he's going to be miming in that top lane, sticking with what he knows. There's big brawlers, and Impaler, he's also gone back to a comfortable champion, which is that Xin Zhao. It seems that Cloud9 Eclipse are considering the final pick. At the moment, they are sitting on a Warwick. We'll see whether that one goes through.
So I very briefly want to touch on the Renekton and Xin Zhao. Renekton is Mima's most played champion. Out of 28 games, he played 11 times in the split. Got a lot of experience on that. Big bully, and also does scale a little better into the late game with some changes to his Dominus. Impaler and Xin Zhao has not played that in many weeks. I distinctly remember a 0-8-4 game in week 2 or week 3 of the LCS where he struggled. He did not have the impact. This is the Feral Flare patch, so he is going to have a boost. He's going to be arguably better at doing his job, but Impaler needs to ensure he improves upon his previous Xin Zhao performances because they were not particularly strong.
Well, the final lock-in was Oduamne having Trundle in the top lane. We'll see and that works out for them. How do we compare these two teams then? This is the first game of a best of five. Who has got the advantage early on?
I feel like Super Hot Crew have got a very good composition to deal with Cloud9 Eclipse on the condition they don't give up kills early. There's a lot of abilities to get rid of the assassins and knock Cloud9 Eclipse away. Wild Growth is going to save you. Solar Flare can save you. Dominus can bring you back to life. If Cloud9 get ahead, I just want to say the Cloud9 Eclipse composition is a next to exact comp that Cloud9 North America, the actual LCS team, has run. Myself and St. Vicious were talking about the Trundle with the assassins and saying, how does it really work? And the theory is that Trundle is going to hold people in place with his pillar, buy time for Kha'Zix and LeBlanc to execute somebody. And assuming they do that, Propzix will have the resets and Distortion can carry on chasing.
Carry on running through the teams. We'll see how it works out, ladies and gentlemen, with the first match ready to go. Let's see who you think will win this series and enter the LCS. According to LOLesports.com, you've picked Cloud9 Eclipse by 74%. That is a big vote for the Challenger Series team.
It is very big, and I would say I would agree with it had Ko been on the roster. I think yes. With Santorin in there, and considering they lost to Ninjas in Pyjamas last week at the Copenhagen Games, I think it's probably closer to 60-40 in favor of Super Hot Crew, but we'll have to keep tabs on the Twitter voting as we get to it.
So here we go, ladies and gentlemen. We are getting game one underway of this promotion series. The Super Hot Crew fighting to retain their spot in the League of Legends Championship Series. Meanwhile, Cloud9 Eclipse on the red team are looking to get themselves in there and maybe fight for one of those world champion spots, which of course the summer is all about. So, level one play. What do we see from this one? Of course, I would give early advantages. Actually, no, it's pretty even, I would say, level one.
Yeah, there is a fair amount of crowd control. Voidal is very aggressive. I think he's moving into the jungle and all gets away with a flash.
Yeah, just a bit of poke, bit of flash, but that summoner spell used already, and that may give a visit for Impaler. We must see whether he decides to go down there. More importantly, whether they're going to stick with their standard meta, whether they're going to go that 4-0 split push, which we've seen so many teams running.
Super Hot Crew are less likely to do that, I think, because they don't have a teleport on Mimer. If you look, Odawamne is running teleport on that Trundle, so if they want to go for the lane swaps and the shenanigans, it's immediately going to put Cloud9 Eclipse in a more advantageous position. On the rest of the summoner spells, that's three summoner heals for Super Hot Crew. They want extended, prolonged team fights because Lulu's going to do great the more Glitter Lancers you can get off. Renekton, the more time he has to bully a team fight with all of those summoner heals will be great. So assuming Super Hot Crew don't mess up those summoner spells, they should actually come away from this laning phase in a pretty good position.
Clearly debating about this late invade. They're not sure which way they want to go. Looks like it's going to be the bottom way in towards there. We can see Mixer and Mr. Rales are down in this bottom half. Mixer is sticking around in that bush, although he's just moved away. They won't have vision of this right now with Cloud9 moving in.
No, there's no wards down for the Super Hot Crew. They have some vision near the top half of the jungle to ensure that Impaler did not get invaded upon. But Santorin, with an early advantage, going to grab himself that red buff.
He's backing away. He's not going to go towards the enemy red buff. It looks like he's going to move towards it. It looks like Cloud9 may have stolen advantage early on here. Let's see. We'll make sure the route of Cloud9, whether Impaler decides to move in towards Cloud9's jungle. It doesn't look like he is. He's going to head back towards the walls and towards his own red buff. He is going to be very upset when he gets around there.
Yeah, and it's one of the things that when you get those buffs, yes, it is good for your team, but it's slightly more about denying the objective from Impaler. So Impaler's going to be one buff down, and he's got the Hunter's Machete, so it's already started stacking up towards the Feral Flare. And Mixer is looking to get some engages, but this is a lane matchup that Leona's going to have a difficult time in until he hits level 6.
Well, you can see Impaler's realized the problem. He's coming straight around, but you can see already Santorin is there. He's taken away that red buff. He's actually been taken fairly low, but he's already taken the double red buff. Impaler's coming around. He's just going to be finding himself two little lizards. And Santorin's like, if you want to clear my camp out, I'm fine with that. But you can step away as Impaler passes by that ward. Good start from Cloud9 Eclipse.
Yeah, very intelligent play. It was very risk-free. Cloud9 had all the numbers on their side. So had Impaler gone for a delayed invade, he would have run the risk of being collapsed on by Odawamne and Febivent. So at the end of the day, he has lost a lot of time because he ran from the bottom half of the map to the top half of the map, and he's lost his red buff. So we'll see how Impaler does. Going to be counting his stacks once he gets that Riggle's Lantern and keeping track of how quickly you can get Feral Flare. Remember, it is 4.5, so it's 25 stacks to upgrade, not 30, which is currently on live.
Impaler is being read like a book as he passes by yet another ward. They know that he's potentially in this lower half of the jungle, which is why we see Cloud9 Eclipse just stepping away ever so slightly. Top lane, we haven't had a chance to talk about that too much. Mima has a fairly sizable advantage. Aduamne will happily farm on his turret, though, so he'll keep that in his favor, and honestly, he's playing very safe right now.
Yeah, you have to. This is a matchup that Mima should start bullying Trundle. We'll see how aggressive he plays it, but you know, it's something we see over and over. We'll get to that in a second as Impaler is coming in the bottom lane. Oh, that's aggressive!
Flash Zenith Blade onto Voidler. I'm not sure if Impaler's gonna get involved in this one. There's the exhaust. He does get the dash on towards him. Three talent strike. Is he gonna land enough? I think he wanted to bounce Yannen. Meanwhile, Selfie in the mid lane. He gets pounced on. Forbidden does take him down with Santorin. A fantastic back and forth action and a one for one.
And we talked about in the pregame how important Mr. Riles was going to be for Super Hot Crew. The first gank from Impaler is on the duo lane, ensuring Mr. Riles gets first blood, gets the kill credit. You go back to pick some bans. Cloud9 and Cliff banned up three mid laners. Selfie plays Ryze. Cloud9 gank their mid lane to get Forbidden a kill early on. So it's a very clear strategy from both of these teams. And the question for Super Hot Crew is, can they ensure they don't give Febiven more kills? Because if Febiven on LeBlanc is finding those picks, he's going to create a very difficult situation for the Super Hot Crew.
Well, Mima might find himself getting paid a visit by the flying Kha'Zix. At the moment, Santorin is ready and waiting to pounce in there. Aduamne happy to pull him closer and closer towards that turret, which is happening. He has got the pillar, remember, to slow his pace down. He's just waiting to pounce in towards him.
Yeah, we're gonna see coming in. Look, this red buff as well. Mima's in trouble.
Comes around, there's the pillar of ice. Does manage to get the unseen threat on him as well. Another hit, but he uses a good slice of dice across the minions and flashes to make sure he's clean.
Successful gank. Even more importantly, the way Santorin has played, within 5 minutes he's had two successful ganks, is immediately telling you he's filling the shoes of Ko. Mixer's going very aggressive. He's caught Yannen.
He's diving on towards him, but the shield comes down from Voidler. I don't think they're going to have enough to turn this one around, but it's good harassment nonetheless. And Mr. Ral is trying desperately to get himself a small advantage in that lane. But at the moment, it's Yannen in the lead.
So thanks to the early gank from Impaler, Mr. Ral and Mixer have the opportunity to play more aggressive in that lane. Mixer at level 4, he's got his spell reel all except for his ultimate, and he's going to keep looking for Yannen. Effective HP is sitting with Mixer and Mr. Ral, so if they catch Yannen again, they can keep going and keep trying to force Yannen to blow his summoner heal or his flash and push him out of lane.
So Yannen's in the lead, of course. Mr. Ral did get that first blood, so he did get himself a fairly sizable advantage on that one. So at the moment, these two are fairly even. Selfie was taken down when that heal was used up by him. Of course, the ignite from Forbidden early on. Forbidden, known for his Riven, but hasn't been able to play it in a very long time. Wasn't even banned away in this one. It's just simply not in the meta for him anymore.
I'm officially not talking about it anymore.
Well, he used to be a top laner.
It's true.
I mean, and it doesn't get chance anymore.
Forbidden, every time he comes into one of these challenger games, we talk about it because we're secretly hoping he plays it.
Yeah.
And you hit the nail on the head. It's really not in the meta. I personally think Forbidden's strongest champion right now is the Nidalee that we touched on. Played it through the Challenger Series playoffs, and he really hits a lot of spears. Santorin with another gank. Mima's got no flash. We'll see if he can get away.
He's just going to get a lot of damage on him. That's what he's going to have. He does manage to use that slice straight away, and it gets him clean. But you can see, you're not going to be comfortable going back into lane with a Kha'Zix waiting in the wings, with a LeBlanc possibly paying you a visit when you're at half hit point.
So repeated ganks in the top lane is allowing Aduamne to overcome Trundle's early game weaknesses to Mima's Trundle. And we've seen Mima bullying LCS top laners in the past. Mima loves to farm in between towers, that first and second turret in the top lane. And he's not been given the chance because he's got no flash, so it's very risky, and Santorin's ganked multiple times. You touched on the fact that Febiven could roam. And thanks to us having standard lanes, which will draw out the laning phase somewhat, it's going to give Cloud9 the opportunity to use the teleport and roaming LeBlanc to find kills. And I think Cloud9 need to do that. They will scale very well into the late game, but I still think in straight up team fights, as long as Super Hot Crew use their heals and wild growths correctly, they should actually be able to survive the burst. And once they've survived the burst, Cloud9 are not going to be the greatest in those prolonged, drawn out team fights.
Thing to keep our eyes on, other than his top lane, which is a brawl back and forth, is those junglers. Impaler, of course, now going towards that Feral Flare. He's going to have to get 25 stacks. We are still only on 4.5 here, not the 30 stacks at the moment, but going to tell you some way to go. You can see it's 11, I think it was there, just spotted out. Meanwhile, Santorin going for a very different build, obviously going towards the Elder Lizard, I believe he's going to head towards. Impaler will actually get his second red buff now that it's spawned.
Yeah, so I think Impaler's done fairly well to recover from the early buff steals from Santorin, but his ganking presence has obviously not been on the same level. He's had one gank in the bottom lane, which did net a kill. So, you know, can't take that away from him. But Santorin was the man that we were talking about for Cloud9. Could he deliver coming into the series? And after 8.5 minutes, he's had 3 successful ganks. He's given a losing lane matchup in the top lane with Odoamnish Trundle a lead. It is minute, of course, but you expect him to be down. You expect Trundle to be losing. So very, very smart play. We're going to start thinking about Dragon in the next 3 to 4 minutes. And Super Hot Crew have had slightly better vision up until this point. We'll need to see how they work out. That's a good flash of gold.
Was the solar flare being used out by Mixer, so ultimate's starting to come down from these supports. Voidal yet to hit level 6, you saw, but Hyannon got out of that one, had to use that flash summoner spell, has got himself his BAF sword, but look at Mr. Rylands. That kill he got early on has given the edge in items, give himself the Vampiric Scepter along with the BAF sword.
Yeah, he really needs to have that sustain. Because Voidal's got the shield, which can block some of the damage onto Hyannon, Mr. Rawls needs to even that out, as we said, with a little bit of sustain from that Vamp Scepter. Mr. Rawls is staying even on CS, and Mixer is continually playing aggressive. What I like about the Karma pickup is that assuming Hyannon or Voidal don't get caught by too much direct CC, oh, look at this, Centaurin's gonna walk straight into 2 members. I think he's in trouble.
Well, he's dead. There's no way out of that one. I got a question, why? Why he went there? They just pinged on Impaler, taking the pink ward down. They saw them. Still, the vision would have just shrunk away as they saw them both heading that way. Why did he walk and face check that bush?
He did not anticipate them camping there. I mean, it's that simple. I think Santorin had assumed they'd gone for a different buff or moved further north, but it wasn't the case, and he gets bug splattered. Santorin gives up an easy kill to Impaler. So Impaler's going to keep stacking up that Riggle's Lantern, getting closer to the Feral Flare, and pretty smart play. The roam from the mid laner, so to speak, actually coming from Super Hawk's side.
Yeah, Impaler actually involved in 100% of the kills so
far. Mima's baiting this.
Mima is trying to bait it. Impaler's been waiting patiently in that bush. Now Mima's taken very low. Here comes Impaler. Has he waited too long? Yes, he has. He is going to get the kill, but that was a little too much bait.
Yeah, I hung around just a tiny bit shorter than he should have. Didn't anticipate the burst from Subjugate and the Bilgewater Cutlass, plus the chomp coming out of Odoamnish. So instantly bursted through Mima's Renekton. That is also a perfect example of how the level 1 Dominus has been made weaker on patch 4.5. You have 100 less hit points on the rank 1 ability. So you could argue that 100, you know, HP difference maybe could have allowed him to survive that gank. Regardless, Mima goes down, second kill to Impaler.
Practice a little more there. Or maybe he was just waiting for Impaler to come in a little bit earlier.
Yeah, let's blame Impaler. He could have come quick. Right? It's his
you
fault.
Always blame the jungler. I mean, it's the easy get out. So far, though, Impaler 2-0-1, working out very well for him. We do see Mr. Ryla's gone back, got that Bloodthirster now complete. He's going to start stacking that one out. We do see Hyannon now backing off as well. We'll see whether he does the same. He did go for those boots earlier on, of course, along with that BF sword. This time around, Santorin is lying in wait to try and get on towards Mima. Remember, there's no Dominus from Mima this time around.
No, there's not, and there's no defensive stats. Mima's gone for a Brutalizer as a first item, which is kind of interesting because, yes, it is an aggressive item. It's not necessarily going to help you with lane pushing like a Hydra would, but it's going to allow him to maybe out-duel Odoamne because he doesn't have as many defensive stats to be stolen away. Now, Mima's still sticking around, does have his flash available, so I'm expecting him to get away. I'm on the assumption Fibiven doesn't come in from behind, because that could be a very scary 3v1.
Fibiven is warded out the blue buff, so Cloud9 continue. Actually, they're going to tower dive on this one, and well, Mima forced the flash away, but he gets out safe, and that was a tower hit for Cloud9, but they're not too worried about that. They've got a good stack of minions, but Mima's going to stick around for now.
So Santorin has only ganked the solo lanes, mid and top. Still thinking about going for the tower dive. Remember, there was a ward placed here by Febivin. So Cloud9 and Clips have got full vision, and this is going to turn into a 2-on-2, probably 3v3, as Mima looks to be rotating. We'll see. Smite's up.
Nope, not this time. Santorin fail jumped and didn't quite time it right. That was quickly taken away and secured by Super Hot Crew. Odoamne's taking some more hits in his top lane. His Subjugate is down, his ultimate. So that's not available if Mimer starts to get a little bit more aggressive, which he seems to be. Selfie managing to try and turn some of that aggression from Verbiven around, quickly turning him into a little pix.
Yeah, there's not much kill pressure in that lane. Unless one player completely misplays or gets caught off guard, there are so many tools available for both individual champions to get away from one another. I want to touch on those items really quickly. The Brutalizer, as we said, by not building defensive stats, Oduwamne's Subjugate's not going to steal defensive from Renekton. On the same token, up until this point, Mr. Riles had actually picked himself up a Mana Potion, which is somewhat untraditional for AD carries, but it just signals how aggressive he wants to be in that lane. And we also see Ionian Boots of Lucidity for Selfie. So he's going for a lot of cooldown reduction very early on. Mimer, no flash, here comes Santorin.
Yeah, Santorin stealthing his way in there, gives him that speed boost. Oh, but Mimer has no flash available this time around. He should close the gap. There's the stealth, the ultimate, managing to close that gap down. And a quick taste of fear from Santorin finishes the deal.
So Impaler has not been in position to counter gank any of those ganks yet. They've been trading one gank for one gank, and Mimer is continually being camped, continually being shut down. Remember Renekton, while he will scale somewhat better into late, Oduwamne's Channel is going to do better. The kill in top has allowed Super Hot Crew to secure an uncontested dragon run.
Yeah, fantastic turnaround, Super Hot Crew reacting very well, knowing that that jungler and top laner are a long way away. It will be the top turret though, for Cloud9 Eclipse here. Oduwamne happy to finish this one out, just letting those few last minions go down before he finishes the turret out. Feral Flare completed by Impaler. Also picked up that Hex Drinker as well. Impaler so far doing very well in the jungle despite that rough start.
Yeah, and he's just stolen the blue buff as well. So Dragon secured, blue buff secured, gonna steal away this Wolf Camp as well. With the Feral Flare locked in, and considering you're gonna have a somewhat of a damage Renekton, Superhawker could try to set themselves up for a Baron a little later on. There's so much sustain on Xin Zhao.
We should also mention, that's a pretty damn early Feral Flare as well. That was within 15 minutes. That's not bad going, so, considering he had no red buff.
Yeah, so straight up lanes, 2v2s, 1v1s, means Impaler has more time to farm his jungle. I would argue at this level, 13 to 15 minutes is the expected time frame in straight up lanes. And it's something that I know I was talking to St. Vicious, and maybe we can even get Dexter to comment on a little bit later. It is pretty standard. During one of Dexter's semi-final games, he actually had a Blade of the Ruined King and a Feral Flare by 15 minutes. But he'd been gifted some kills and he was farming like a monster.
So. He did, so we discussed that one yesterday, didn't we? Yeah, he said, yeah, I was kind of fed in the game. Yeah. And it worked out very well for them. We'll see how it develops, though, for Super Hot Crew and Cloud9. At the moment, the top lane has fell fairly even, despite the multiple attempted ganks on Mimer's life. He has stayed alive for the most part of it. Is, of course, 0-2-1 has the most deaths on his team. Impaler involved in everything so far for the Super Hot Crew with his 2-0-1 and has farmed very well up against Santorin, who so far has stepped up his game, it seems, to try and fill Ko's boots.
Yeah, with the exception of being caught out in the jungle, with the exception of one bad positional mistake, he has done a very good job. I want to talk about Selfie's build. He's gone for those Ionian Lucidity boots and an Athene's, and he's sitting at 38.7% cooldown reduction. It's slightly different to what we see of mid lane Lulu's, and with a amp time, oh, we'll get into this in a second. I think they're going for Mr. Ral.
Mr. Ral is completely deep on this one. You can see Mixer trying to do what he can to support him. Solar Flare goes down. Mr. Ral is trying to get the lifesteal down. Just not enough. Exhaust comes out from Mixer. Now Impaler joins the party. We can see Santorin backs away from that one. Three Talent Strike bounces over Oduwamne in there. They're going to try and turn this one out. The Zenith Blade missed when he was walking in a straight line. Not exactly sure how you do that at this level.
Selfie's getting popped.
Well, Selfie's going to have to use that Wild Growth for Bimin all over him, though. He's going to get the resets, dives back in towards it. Selfie's in all sorts of trouble, but he does seem the cooldowns are on his favor, and Forbidden has to back out.
Yeah, thanks to the very high amount of cooldown reduction that Selfie has built up, he's going to have a lot more spell reels to cast off. And the reason it's so interesting is, Lulu's, oh, Mixer's gone in again.
Mixer's gone very deep on that one. He's going to get away with it, though, because he's so close to that tower, and Hyannon was getting himself some free farm. This game is definitely opening up suddenly with that open bottom tower going down.
Yeah, as soon as these teams have started to rotate around the map a little bit more, we're seeing more action. At the end of the day, Cloud9 Eclipse are still behind because they have given up that jungle, the dragon rather, so and an additional, just the one tower actually. 2,000 gold down on a pick based composition that needs to be finding kills is not a good sign. Yes, they will scale, but assuming Super Hot Crew buys magic resist and avoids getting blown up instantly, I actually think Super Hot Crew are in a very good position at the stage of the game.
At the moment, it seems very even. Advantage in gold is to the Super Hot Crew, but of course they are even in towers. And can advantage is to Cloud9 Eclipse, but of course objectives is what it's all about. Nobody as of yet taking a gigantic lead. Selfie getting himself that blue buff, that's going to help him out up against these aggressive LeBlanc in the mid lane who has not really got snowballing just yet. That's kind of what you need on these ribbons. He's going to sense out and try and protect that ward. And instantly, we see, I think it was Mixer that put a ward straight on top of the last one.
Yeah, just making sure they've got the vision. They don't want to get flanked. That's the worst thing that can happen to the Super Hot Crew against this Cloud9 composition, is having Trundle teleport from the sideline and giving Santorin and Febiven all the time in the world to get their burst down and to get their damage out. Febiven hasn't actually roamed maybe quite as much as you would expect or think because of the fact that Selfie's been shoving that wave and prevented Febiven really from leaving his mid lane.
We're waiting to see. Mixer is going to get poked by Voidle. Voidle, of course, played a lot of games with Gambit during the summer season. Very experienced
Went
player.
To Worlds.
Went to Worlds as well, yeah. He's probably the most experienced player on the board at the moment, whatever you'd like to refer to it as. I'm wondering, there we go. That's what I was waiting for. LeBlanc has been back and spent that money. He's got himself that needlessly large ready. He had a lot of gold in the bag, which means that will be available. Dragon is up in, well, 45 seconds. We can see the team starting to position for this one, and the pink war fight has begun.
So I like Super Hot Crew's straight up 5v5 scenario as long as they are grouped. They are not currently tight enough group for me to liken their chances of getting this dragon. If Cloud9 decide to engage when there are three members of Super Hot Crew in the river, Cloud9 have got more burst in single target that they can get through a smaller skirmish squad of Super Hot Crew. So I like the fact that Super Hot Crew have backed away. They're going to regroup and we'll see how quickly Mr. Rawls rejoins the rest of his team.
And let's not forget, there is that teleport on Odoamne. He's happy to stay in that top lane. Meanwhile, Miner has to get involved. Impaler gets that 3-turn strike on Santorin. Santorin having to leap away from this one. So that's a lot of damage down. Ooh. Speaking of damage, Selfie just gets exploded there. Doesn't quite go down. There's the Cullen coming out, followed up by the Solar Flare. But Bibbon goes down. Selfie does the job.
Very well coordinated by Super Hot Crew. They landed their abilities. They didn't hesitate. The moment Santorin's clearing out that pink ward, Impaler instantly jumped in there. So Super Hot Crew grab a kill and the mid turret and most likely the dragon as well.
Now we saw Odoamne trying to head back here to help out. Mimo tracked him the whole way. Now he's backed away, safe in the presence. This will be a 4v4 regardless. It seems the dragon will go across the Super Hot Crew.
Very decisive play from Super Hot Crew. They played the laning phase patiently, even with Mimo giving up two kills. You never felt like Super Hot Crew were falling behind. They've got a 5,000 gold lead. They've rotated for objectives. They've grouped up at the right time. And they haven't hesitated at picking fights when they see an opportunity available to them. So well played. Now is the more difficult task. How do they get past this last outer turret and start pushing into the inner jungle? If you look at the vision for Super Hot Crew, it's very good in and around the Dragon Pit. They need to extend that, push that into Cloud9's half of the map, and then get control of the game that way.
This is something we saw yesterday. Once the current LCS teams, with they are current LCS teams, they're trying to fight to get back in towards the summer, but they've been dealing with these rotations for the last 28 games. The promotion series teams that are coming through, the challengers, Cloud9 Eclipse, the NIP yesterday, and of course we've got Denial coming up later, really haven't had a chance to deal with these rotations. And I'm thinking towards maybe the Copenhagen Wars later. They are one of the biggest teams that does rotations. This is going to be really hard for these challenger teams to compete with because they don't get a chance to practice it.
So two things that I want to touch on. Copenhagen Wolves in the next series, not only are they good at rotations, they are the best LCS team at 2v1s because they do it so often. And this is a meta where you can get away with that. Going back to Cloud9, not having to deal with rotations? No, because they played ninjas in pajamas for the last 3 months.
Yeah.
Don't rotate around the back. So, you know, they're in this mindset where you can see Cloud9 are being outpositioned. Probably we're being a little too harsh because it is only game one of the series, and we need to see them find their feet, you know, warm up, get into the groove, and try to predict what Super Hot Crew are doing. I do want to touch on the item build from Selfie. It looks like he's building a Deathfire Grasp, and Athene's Deathfire Grasp is not a Lulu build we see ever. So we need to see how effective it is. For the time being, it's working out.
We'll see how aggressive it is. Maybe trying to face the aggression of Febiven on that LeBlanc. Trying to counter it. So it looks like Hyannon's got himself some free time on this turret. Mr. Rollins is heading down here, but I think it's going to be gone before he even gets close. And there's a big wave of minions. Don't think he fancies a straight up 1v1 fight. Now the teleport's coming in. Odoamne is there as well. just a support. Wasn't really a required teleport, though, in my eyes.
Yes and no. The teleport, I think, did save Hyonan. If you notice Mix's positioning and Mr. Rawls, they could have jumped onto Hyonan to get the kill, but now the teleport is down for the next two and a half minutes, because it went 2 minutes. Now, Super Haku groups up in the mid lane. You see Mixer is zoning two members of Cloud9, and they're getting some auto attacks on the top.
Speed and rotations, full effect right now. Cloud9 Eclipse going to try and counter this one. Odoamne now realizing he may be putting himself in a dangerous position. That was almost certainly Hyonan they're focused on, but they'll be happy to got some damage down towards Odoamne. It is Super Hot Crew now in all sorts of problems. Mimer taking the big damage there. Santorin trying to use that stealth, trying to get his advantage, trying to get in position, trying to get some claws on towards that carry, but it is Super Hot Crew going back in there. There's going to be the ultimate coming out. Odoamne getting focused on. He's taking a hell of a lot of damage for the tankiest member of the game. We proved he has a built tank. That's going to be Santorin. He's going to get caught out. One kill for the Super Hot Crew. They're trying to get on towards Hyonan. Hyonan's going to run for his life. He is the brain of the team, it seems, but this time around, he is going to have to try and use some brawn to get out of that situation.
Super Hot Crew's composition works out flawlessly. Nobody gets burst down. They've got heals. They've got knockups from Wild Growth. They've got knockaways from Xin Zhao's Crescent Sweep. If you look at this team fight, this is exactly what the Super Hot Crew wanted. They managed to keep themselves nice and tightly knit. The knockaway forces Cloud9 to reposition and try to pick a target. They're trying to focus Impaler. Mr. Rawls has gone untouched for the entirety of this fight. And look at Santorin. He recommits onto the jungler while Mr. Rawls is just sitting there hammering away from the middle of the fight. The longer these fights go, the more spell rotations both Renekton and Lulu are going to get off, and the better the sustain from Impaler is going to be. He's got a Randian Zoman, Hex Drinker, and that Feral Flare. With his W, he's going to be healing on hit a whole bunch of HP, and I don't think there's enough sustained damage with Cloud9 to deal with him, let alone the rest of the team.
And while that was all happening, there was the middle inner turret going down. Super Hot Crew manages to secure that one after that fight. So they gained an objective as well as some kills. And that's, of course, giving them a 6,000 gold lead. Blue buff, that's going across towards Forbidden. He needs that. He needs to start making some plays in his mid lane because currently Super Hot Crew are definitely forming as a five-man unit very effectively.
6,000 gold. They've got that inner turret. We talked about how Super Hot Crew needed to get some deep vision. They've got some wards on Cloud9's side of the jungle, and by zoning, by forcing Cloud9 and Eclipse away, if you go all the way back to Odoamne's teleports in that bottom lane, that forced him and Hyonan to be on the opposite side of the turret that Cloud9 wanted to defend, which allowed Super Hot Crew to funnel them and channel him into a lane where they could start a fight. The one thing that I think I'm taking away from the both teams' play is Super Hot Crew are forcing Cloud9 to dance at their beat, and that is what is allowing Super Hot Crew to win these objectives and these rotations and get this nice lead that they've built up.
Well, they've done this against some of the best in the business. They've beaten every single team, including the likes of Fnatic and Gambit, and of course SK Gaming, who managed to finish first in the league overall, but the playoffs went to Fnatic, and they have taken a victory off every single one of those teams. So Super Hot Crew, they certainly know how to play League of Legends in the European scene, and Cloud9 Eclipse are currently being treated to Super Hot Crew, who themselves admitted they were nervous coming into this game. They are going to be very confident with the way they're playing right now.
Yeah, this is one of the more patient control games we've seen, and Super Hot Crew just keep extending the lead. I want to touch on Selfie's build again. With the success, I feel, of those last few pushes across the map, Selfie's actually completed his death cap, so this is the more traditional build that we've seen. I got all excited that he's going to DF. Maybe it was a bit too quick, maybe this is always the game plan, or you could theorize, with the dragons and the towers, he got more gold so he could just complete his death cap quicker. We will never know unless we interview him. So we'll just have to keep our eyes on that. Regardless, another dragon goes the way of Super Hot Crew.
Maybe just double-click the Fiendish Codex by mistake.
But you know what? It could be that simple, right? It could be that simple, and maybe I'm just reading way too much into it. But who knows? Who knows?
Baron is being started. 27 minutes. Well, we do see Cloud9 moving to this one.
Look how quickly
it's
going
down.
There's
not a lot of vision, I've got to be honest, over that pit wall. Now they see that ward going down. They're going to come around. Voidal might get caught out here. Impaler can jump on him. He does get the three talent strike. There's the bounce in the air. That is a good cover off, but Solar Flare is going to stop him in his tracks. And that support Voidal is down.
Yeah, he just got caught out of position. The engage power of Xin Zhao running at you when you get the movement speed buff from Lulu, which scales on your ability power, you are not going to get away, even with Karma, who is actually very quick. There was an exhaust there for Voidal, he didn't waste it. They might jump on Centauron, there are a lot of dashes. Selfie's gonna zone.
Selfie finds him, there's a little poke. They want to take the Baron down this time around, they may have to peel off once again. Baron down half hit points.
Forbiven
is, of course, looking to try and get a good distort. If they group up like that once again, he'll take a big chunk of damage on towards him. He's not too weak. There he goes. Goes in towards the pit. The Baron, though, goes across to the Super Hot Crew. They're going to try and turn. Are they going to chase? No, I think they're going to be wise to back away.
And again, just control play. Super Hot Crew just timed. They didn't burst down the Baron quickly. They waited until Cloud9 were in vision. And then when they realized the steal potential wasn't there, they just finished it off. I think this is just really decisive, intelligent play from the Super Hot Crew.
With the magic burst of Forbiven, we do see Impaler now completing the Mora Mammordius, taking that Hex Drinker in towards that one. He has, of course, got their Ranyan's Omen. He's had a while, and that Feral Flare, which was stacked up high. So, Super Hot Crew currently in a commanding position. 9,000 gold advantage, 4-2 in turrets, and you can see across the gold, the spread of it all. They have around about 2,000 gold advantage over most members, most of their lane partners. The only one that is fairly close, I would say, is still those two top laners who we saw going head-to-head. That was where Santorin was focusing, and it has kept Mima down compared to the rest of his team.
Yeah, it really has. The problem is, because of how far ahead the rest of Super Hot Crew are, even though Oduwame is even, he can't sit in the front line. He can't sit there and get beat on by Zinzal, Lulu, and Lucian. He doesn't have the ability to sustain through that damage. Trundle is going to do pretty well at the split pushing with his Blade of the Ruined King, but truthfully, I just think Super Hot Crew, they've shown a tendency to dive and engage, and with Zinzal, Lulu, and Leona, they can go under a tower if they want to.
Pink ward, they just put down Super Hot Crew. Wasn't quite in the bush, so they can't see the ward that's in the bush. It's a bit of a mistake, that one, but these are the... These shouldn't be too effective. Oh. The ward's timed out anyway.
Oh, whoopah. So
that's all good.
That's a little unfortunate. But we do see Super Hot Crew getting that deep vision. It's what we talked about. With the information at their disposal, they can just push on this inner turret, and I don't think Cloud9 can defend this. Oh, oh, that's a Solar Flare.
Good poke. Solar Flare doesn't really land. It separates the rest of Cloud9 and does enough to drive them away from the tower. That's all they wanted. Another turret down, another inner turret down, more importantly. They're going to rotate around and see what they want next.
Bottom tower, blue buff to bottom tower would be my prediction. The minion wave is pushing towards the Super Hot Crew, so that somebody needs to go and shove that back up. But the way Super Hot Crew are playing, use the wards that they've got in the inventory, ward up the blue side of the jungle, and then just start sieging the turret. You know, truthfully, they're tanky enough to just base tank it if they wanted to, but I think Cloud9 will be able to respond quickly enough, so they're going to wait for the minion wave.
Perfectly timed, blue buff spawn, Super Hot Crew take that away. They're not too worried about this bottom wave. They want to try and shove straight in on the mid, it seems. Mima was doing a good job at driving it in towards the inhibitor turret. I think they realized no reason to go too aggressive. We can play safe. There's a lot on the line in these promotion tournaments. Of course, getting in towards that summer LCS position, it secures them the team a salary and a position, and more importantly, a chance at fighting towards that world final spot.
Yeah, Super Hot Crew have not made a risky play. I mean, if you were to summarize the last 30 minutes of action, it is Super Hot Crew decisive initiations with very low risk. You never feel like, oh my word, that's scary. Why are they going in this? It's Cloud9 always retreating, Cloud9 always on the back foot. So Baron buff is still on Super Hot Crew for probably another 30 odd seconds. I do think the game plan for them will be to get vision in the blue buff area of Cloud9 and Eclipse, and then push down that last inner turret before they start sieging the inhibitor turrets, which is always the most difficult tower to siege. And assuming Mixer hits a good Solar Flare, that could be their way in for tower diving. But if that Solar Flare misses, it opens up Super Hot Crew to engage or re-engage.
And you could argue, if you look at this match, if you look at the matchups right now, nobody had a big lane advantage. There was no lane advantages gained here. This was purely from Super Hot Crew's movement and positioning around the map, controlling really where Cloud9 and Eclipse would take them. They've been controlling the whole game as we've moved around. And as you mentioned, Mixer, who himself has not had the best of seasons, I think it's safe to say, with that record deaths, is 0-0-4, yet to die, and has been diving in against the Cloud9 Eclipse.
Yeah, so you are right. Mixer hasn't had the best statistics, but because of the extremely high amount of deaths he's given up, it has afforded Mr. Rawls all of that additional time to get his incredibly good stats.
Yes.
You know, you always need to take into account...
He's the sacrificial lamb.
He is the sacrificial lamb. And, you know, at the end of the day, Super Hot Crew, they did get 10 wins out of 28, so we'll see if they can start closing us off. That is a massive amount of Burst of Kjarnan, and that's going to force Cloud9 away.
Another inner turret gain for the Super Hot Crew as they move on towards those inhibitor turrets. Mima taking a bit of poke out from Forbiven there. They are going to start getting a couple of hits on towards those inhibitor turrets. He did see the poke, as you mentioned, Kjarnan. That was just one little glitter lance coming out from Selfie along with that pixie on him. And it shredded half his hit points down. They've got to be careful they don't get picked off like that.
The wave clear from Cloud9 is very short range. There's not enough ability power on Voidal to clear the wave safely. And in order for Graves or LeBlanc to go in, they put themselves in solar flare range, which is why you're noticing Kjarnan using his smoke screen to try to slow the minion wave down and then look for a buckshot. Super Hot Crew have done a very good job of controlling the minimap. Minions in both the top and middle wave are pushing towards Cloud9 Eclipse. So Super Hot Crew will have the option to peel away from this turret to try to force an objective elsewhere on the map. Keep in mind, Baron's up in a minute and a half as well, so Super Hot Crew could just force Cloud9 to leave their base to challenge for Baron as well, if they want to play this very safe.
So they're going to rotate around. The dragon is now up. Oh, they're going to try and focus on Mr. Rallis. They tried to go deep for Bibbon there, but they will back away. Super Hot Crew safe in this one. They're going to be taking Barry White over on the right-hand side, making sure that one locks down. Larry is, of course, on the left. At the moment, though, Super Hot Crew dragging up. Let's just rotate down then.
Yeah, I'm expecting Baron to most likely be the next play for Super Hot Crew. They don't have the highest amount of wards. Actually, they've got no wards in the inventory except for one pink. So I would expect them to back, buy some more wards, get vision around Baron, and then force Cloud9 to respond to Baron. Once Super Hot Crew get Baron buff on their side, they're more likely to tower dive because of all the bonus stats and the regen and the extended sieging power that it gives you. So I think, once again, smart, low-risk play from the Super Hot Crew.
Everybody from the Super Hot Crew backs the base, spends up the gold, and moves back into position for 30 seconds until the Baron spawns. Pink Ward is still residing in the pit. That's not going anywhere because Cloud9 Eclipse have not been able to get around there and clear it out. They've got the vision around the back of the pit, but nothing quite in there yet. Just that one ward, which will get swept out in just a moment by Impaler.
So I want to touch on an item that Mix has picked up on Leona. He's gone for the Warmog's armor, which has given him a very big chunk of HP. More importantly, the benefit that that's going to give you with Face of the Mountain, he now has a 400 hit point shield that he can put onto Mr. Rawls at any given time. Mr. Rawls only has 2,200 hit points, so that is a very, very effective shield. We'll see if it comes into play in this next team fight. As we touched on, vision inside of Cloud9, I don't think there's enough for Super Hot Crew, but they've got enough to work with as they've got Baron down to about half HP.
Voidal getting the poke in there, Mima running interference, getting blocked off. There's the Pillar of Ice already being used up here, but this Baron is dropping. The Bivin comes across here. He tries to cause problems. There's going to be the Baron going down. That was locked in by Impaler. Now the rest of Cloud9 get decimated by the Super Hot Crew. You can see they're trying to capture on towards it. Santorin, he's going to run for his life. That's a double kill being picked up by Mima. And well, they're just swept aside as the Super Hot Crew move towards his top inhibitor turret and maybe try and lock onto Voidal. Oh, the Glitter Lance catches. He's in trouble. That's going to be gifted across. Who will take it? Selfie will finish.
Selfie on Lulu is doing work for the Super Hot Crew, but the reason that team fight was so effective is Super Hot Crew landed a solar flare that locked up members of Cloud9, who then all got knocked up by the Wild Growth. If I'm going to be completely pedantic, they stacked it a little much, but the fact that Cloud9 were so tightly knit and so tightly grouped for the steal, Super Hot Crew just gave a flawless game one in the series.
Fantastic start to the series. This is a best of five, remember, but Super Hot Crew already looking very confident in this early game. It's a 37-minute victory, ladies and gentlemen. Let's not take too much away from this one, though, because NIP locked down their first game in 35 minutes. They ended up to lose 3-2. Super Hot Crew got to be careful with their confidence as they move into game two. But it was a very, very strong start from them. Great rotation throughout the game.
I completely agree with you on the confidence point. This game was just so well coordinated and so well controlled by the Super Hot Crew that if they channel the same sort of calm demeanor that the rest of the series, this is what we talked about. This is the experience they've developed over the last 11 weeks of playing in the LCS, and they just hit all the checkpoints.